thanks to Chris and Tamika for choosing to come and speak today. I must admit, I haven't held true to the original brief or abstract I sent in. I was going through photos and things. I just started changing my presentation a bit, but we'll still... You can't hear me? I'd rather not speak into that. Where's the... So, nice little picture there, but that's unfortunately in South Australia, it's in Victoria, that I haven't seen any blue devils over here, but I'm told me they do exist. So, reintroducing native grass landscape. I guess, can I just have a show of hands what people are expecting, because the top picture up there is some of Paul Gibson Roy's work, so it's a diverse grassland with forbs and herbs. And the bottom picture is actually Chris Finlay there and one of his patches in Victoria, and it's obviously just Dan Fonius board. So what are people after? Are they after just a native grass board of one or two species? Show of hands. Right. And what about everyone else? Is everyone else after a diverse top picture? Okay. There seems to be a contention about scalping versus just doing chemical weed control, and I know a lot of people are against the idea of scalping, but in the rehabilitation industry there's actually a precedent for that, I realised when I was going through my photos. And the bottom couple of pictures are of a Burford tree seeder, single line tree seeder, and also the V-blade seeder, same thing. All that technology's been around for 3 decades. And it actually uses an offset disc or a V blade to scalp the soil away and place the seed in a single line. So it's not actually a new concept for native seeding. It's just obviously we're trying to do grass, we're trying to do a broad scale. A couple of pictures there, the small tractor in it, that's up at the Cairnman 2 mine. So that's been taken off with a scraper. And then the centre photo is Craigburn Farm, Craigburn Farm. The Uber projects that's been put aside with a grader. Both those sites have been quite successful from what I understand. And in terms of scale, a lot of the stuff that's been done is pretty small scale, and people go, well, how do we step it up for big projects? Those big tractors at the bottom are the tractors that are used over the mine I work at, and they remove all the topsoil and replace it when they're finished. And each one of those buckets can carry 14 cubic metres. So, and they still can be accurate in terms of what they take off down to sort of 100 mil, between 50 and 100 mil. So you can take out a fair area of land in a fairly short space of time. And it reiterates, just to go back to that, what Chris has said, Paul Gibson Roy, if anyone's seen his work, it's the same thing. It's like if you want those diverse forblands, grasslands, all this sort of stuff, that's going to get you your best result. It's not going to suit all soil types, it's not going to suit every situation. Okay, harvesting of native grass seeds. My first job in the natives industry was being sent up to Paluna and stuck in a grass harvester and to harvest a couple of tonnes of triadia seed. And so brush harvest is my first experience with native grass seed harvesting. And I've sort of gone away from, there's all these different machines, and I'm fascinated with John Stafford's fantastic devices that he created, and I've mucked around with all sorts of stuff myself. But the little grass harvester that's in the front of that quad bike, it's made by a fella over in New South Wales, Paul Ersey, and it's a great little machine. $5,000, and it just works. It's not as efficient as some of the big ones, but those big ones are like $20,000, $30,000 to construct. And you've just got a situation in South Australia where we've only got small remnants or smaller seed production areas, and for the same money you can have 3 or 4 people running around with those small ones, targeting different sites or whatever. And the bottom one's a little contraption of my own making, which is just a wire on BMX wheels. It's actually quite effective, so yeah. Seed production areas, nothing new. They've been around for a long time, and we've been building them here in South Australia for quite some time. There's a few different types there. There's a broadacre one, which is the ones with the irrigation of the grasses, chorus, thinner, and bluegrass at the top. and the grass and ground cover project ones, which are the phone boxes, and some of my favourites, which is the weed bank. People think seed production areas have to be massive, great big things, and that you could easily do this, the smallest one, just to the left here, the left of the screen. I just got it on my shed. It's only, I don't know, 50 or 80 square metres or something like that, and I was just growing some forbs and herbs and things like that. So you could easily, with a land care group, set small ones up with one species in it, and that person just looks after one species, so they're not having to harvest all the whole season. They can just concentrate on one thing. Because if you ask Andrew Fairney, or Chris Finlay, or Ian Shivers, or Danny Tallboy, seed production areas are a lot of work. They're not about just turning up and just harvesting whenever you feel like it at the end of the season, because your seeds have been predated, or it's blown away, or it's germinated on the plants, or whatever. They're a lot of work. They're a great tool. They require work. Now, another thing I had a crack at for a while was to try and get it through some of the mechanical seed boxes is getting seed pelletized, clay coated, and for it, but I'm just not convinced. And it is useful. Having the pelletized seed will go through some live seed boxes. It won't just flow through everything like is often said, and it's handy for hand broadcasting, but it's a lot of money and you're better off just buying more seed and get more seed out on your site, or put the money into weed control. Been there, done that, that's just my experience. Seed testing, I don't want to say too much about that there, because Alice covered pretty much all of it, but I just want to reiterate, what are you buying? Like the top photo of all the thimble thatch, and there's another picture of the guy's hand, it's Dave Franklin's hand over in Victoria. He had that thimble seed, and it's been cleaned down to pure seed, so he uses that in his nursery. And he said to me, out of a pile of thatch like that, you're getting 5% or less viable seed. So what are you buying? This is the thing you need to know. And again, to reiterate what Alice was saying, we also had some casuarina seed over at the mine I collect for, and we had a batch of seed from another supplier, casuarina pauper. It's 12,000 live seeds per kilogram, and we had a batch that we collected, 120,000 live seeds per kilogram. So, but you wouldn't know that because there's by looking at it, because there's a lot of seed mimics in it, and you need someone of Alice's skill to recognise that. But that's the data you need so we can sort out seeding rates. Species selection. I've seen a lot of even native grasses, tube stock in things like porous and Eniopogon. Those things are weak perennials, or annuals maybe even annualised in poor seasons, so they don't last in the landscape. The great pioneer species. You've got to have a long-term view about where your site wants to go. And things like Microlina, not that suitable for a bunch of South Australia, really we're stuck with Themida. And that top picture is Enteropogon, that's not very far from where we are. That's just a paddock that gets thatched once a year, and it's a solid sward of Enteropogon. And that's been holding out weeds for forever. Well, not forever, obviously, but time that I've been driving past that block. So, and things like Danfonia, a few people have already commented that seems to drop out after a while, depending on the species. I've used Danfonia, I'm not going to use Ripper Sperma, I'm a bit sick of the plant taxonomists changing all my reference books and making them obsolete. But Danfonia in that picture, that's Danfonia fulva, and that's a fairly long lasting swarp. I've used Danfonia geniculata, and that's gone in two seasons. Even for the first season, we got a really good response from it, and it's just started dropping out. Now, so mechanical and hand broadcasting. I like tinkering. I come from a farming background. Those three seeders on there are all my. Each year, I sort of rehash my seeder and get new press wheels and things sent out from the States and try those on and spend. I know tens of thousands of dollars mucking around with it. And in the end, most of the time, I would, those machinery was used for sowing forbs and herbs, especially canopods. And I just got to a point where we can't use Skyper through these. Elemis is hard. A lot of Danfonias and things, most of the species we want to use here in South Australia are difficult to put out there. We're overthinking it. Let's go back to basics, hand seed. And I know that people go, you can't cover the areas, but I know that I was seeding on the Northern Expressway, 2 hectares a day by myself with 4 people, So you can tackle some pretty big areas. You don't have to have the latest, fanciest direct seeding machine that, you know. I think we still need to have people like John working along those lines, because if we go really big scale one day, you need those sort of the technology. But we shouldn't stop getting on with doing native grass restoration or reintroduction just because we get stuck on, you know, that aspect of it. We can just gotta get the seed in the ground. Biomass weed management. Selective herbicides are a great tool if you use them carefully. This is actually a picture out of his seed production area, and his operator just stuffed up the rates of the selective herbicide. In the front of the picture there, you can see it's taken out a big chunk of the native grass. Chris said it's the cleanest bay he's got, a weed-free bay. But it just goes to show that, as I said, they're useful tools, selective herbicides, but herbicides, goes back to the scalping. If your project lends itself to scalping, then you don't have to even worry about, getting the timing or the rates and things of these herbicides right. Now, slashing. There's been a few questions about slashing and things already. I spent a lot of time on a tractor, in vineyards, and then also with biomass management, just on road sites, and also native grasses. At Ann Prescott's urging, I bought a flail mower rather than a rotary slasher, because it leaves the material spread evenly across the whole sward rather than the intensive slash windrow. Thanks, John. But even then, I knew what I was doing, but I'd have sites which we slash 1 year, they come back no worries, and then the next year you hit them about the same time, and then you've just damaged the grasses. And I know that from reading more recent reference books, the tougher grasses, they suggest anything less than 100mm, 4 inches, is going to damage them. Unless you're doing what John was suggesting before, Joseph was suggesting before, if you're slashing your site really regularly, several times or a dozen times a year, well, the grasses are adjusted to that then, and you can slash them low. But if you're only doing one or two slashes a year, and you put it through the tougher grass site, which is most of the grasses we deal with here, or your stipers, your wallaby grasses, your interpogans, things like that, you're going to damage the grasses and you're going to leave it there. Well, I've even seen that on the North Expressway where I sowed exotic grasses along that had tall fescue and perennial ryegrass, again, slash too low, and it's just come back to Kaikouria and Galenia. So even those tough exotic grasses couldn't even hold up against a slashing regime that's too low. And I'm not having a go at the contractors, because a couple of them are in the room here, and I work occasionally. It's about the regime that the department's set and things like that, because it has to be done at a certain time to fire management and those sort of things. And as someone suggested before too, slashing, councils are shocking for it, and contractors not always as well. Weed movement, I've even ended up with Galenia in my yard from using my tractor. It's just about keeping it clean, and then having Galenia get in my own yard, but I used to run around with the tractor. Well, it's coming on my slasher, hasn't it? So even though I've gone to a lot of trouble to keep it clean, obviously I haven't got everything. So they're really great tools for keeping biomass down, but they're also great tools for moving the weed around. I think grazing's a great tool. I used to live up in Clare, and I was involved with the Mid North Grass Ants working group, and they done some fantastic things with rotation grazing of sheep. I couldn't find any sheep pictures, so this is a picture of probably the original grass grazers here in Australia. And surely they were instrumental in, I'm speculating, they were instrumental in a lot of grassland, maintain all the grasslands, because you get big mob of kangaroos like this, where they'll be reds or greys, and they move into a grassland area, mow them down, and then they will hop off to the next patch. Because if you're going to use grazing, you need those intensive grazing pits with a long rest period. I've had people I've met on farmers and things doing restoration projects, they go, yeah, I'm crash grazing the reed veg. and you go in there and you've got three sheep in the green. I just leave them there for 3 months crash grazing. Okay, crashing into your fences and your trees and things. Okay, burning's a great tool, and this has been brought up by Wayne and John and some other people as well. It's a great tool for producing biomass, because unless you've got the other abilities of baling up your biomass, like your squat, then it's a great way of removing it, and you don't have to worry about it, it just goes up in smoke, literally. So this is actually on the Northern Expressway seed production area, and I use that fire fairly extensively at the right timing. So this is an autumn burn for Danfonia, and used to do spring burns for the seed ball grasses. And it also gives you an opportunity too, I never got around to doing it at the seed production area, but it also gives you an opportunity to apply, once you've done a burn, to apply pre-emergent herbicides after. That's why you've got a bare soil surface, which is quite a potentially good way of managing all your winter new grasses, which are really hard to take out. Broadleaf's easy to take out of grassy swards, as most people will know, but not those any grassy weeds. So, to me, where are the Lemandras? Where are your team years' time, take the grandchildren to, you know, have a long-term view on when that project's going to go. So, there are a couple of pictures of some of the projects I've been involved with. This is a project I did with Succession Ecology, Glen Christie, and it's actually a landfill site, a phytocap blend, is that what she calls it? Yeah. So we mainly used, there's a bit of tube stock planting in there as a canopy, and we mostly used Ostracoma verbosa and a few different wallaby grass species. And that site did a great job of colonising the site. This is pretty low rainfall, this is 350 mil. So it's pretty good to get an outcome of the native grasses of that and spot the rubbish that kept blowing around on us. And yeah, this is the photo on the right. Then Kylie supplied it to me yesterday, and you can actually see the Danfonia starting to come through, the spikes starting to drop out. So it just goes to show that succession, that, you know, the climate is starting to.
Jim, that's also, should say, it's a 14 hectare site.
It's a 14 hectare site.
So it's like that.
Yeah, and we hand seeded that. It's 14 hectares, and that was all hand seeded as well, hand broadcast seeding. So it just goes to show you know, when we talk about air broadcasting, it's not just 1,000 square metre sites, they're, you know, reasonably substantial sites, and you can still get great results if you need certain coverage. This is the Northern Expressway, a project that this is photos 4 or 5 years old now, and on two different parts of the Northern Expressway. And if you drive past those areas today, you won't see the native grasses there. They're gone, they drop out, you know. And it's a combination of drought and mowing regimes and things like that, so it's pretty sad. I was pretty impressed with that outcome. Ben was pretty impressed. He actually went out and harvested using those as seed production areas essentially, and harvested the seed from them, and now they're gone. So it just goes to show that you can get results up front. We had a lot of issues along that site. We had some really good results, we had some really poor results. A lot of it's because it's Adelaide Plains soils. What Chris was saying about a lot of them rotary hoe, they've got huge weed seed banks, lots of nutrients. You know, possibly chemical toxicity from the amount of chemicals that apply to the herbicides and fungicides and things like that. So, yeah, for one site we sowed two times with mostly Kenopod mix, and that failed, and we sowed native grass, and that failed as well. So, it's just a weedy paddock now. It's all just going to be good for. So. And Draw Duffer East. That's Danny looking fairly. Squab in his contemplating over the grass grabber, thinking Tim's got a quad bike to push that down, but I've got to push it by hand. Thanks. Yeah, so that's been a fairly successful patch of Danfonia, and we've had good success out of that site and some poor results. So just comparing between seasons. One thing I will say about that site especially has demonstrated to me that you need patience with your projects, especially with direct seeding. And this goes for tree and shrub direct seeding, as well as native grass direct seeding. The site we're going to look at, tomorrow. The last bit I did on that project before it sort of went into a maintenance phase, sowed that, and the then project officer at the time said to me, didn't work, Tim, it's pretty shit, it's weedy. Doesn't work. I'm going, okay, that's a bit disappointing. Anyway, 3 years later, I went on the phone. I can't believe I'm standing out here and there's just all this grass and there's this and that and whatever. And it just goes to show you just need to bide your time, you know, and you need to look more really good results straight away. So. And this is actually my neighbour's paddock.
Is the dog still there? Just can't see it anymore.
Yeah.
Who's neighbours?
But yeah, it's my neighbour's paddock, and I noticed there's some native grass in there, and all they've been doing is his late father-in-law used to go out with the Toronto mower several times a year and keep it down. And when he passed away, I said, well, do you mind if I look after it for you, because it was just a fellow paddock. So this is it just goes to show it's out at Roseworthy, which is from vegetation maps that I've seen that Major and Checkers provided in the past and things. Roseworthy was very much a grassland system, not good, great, that's why it's great cereal country, not good for growing trees, not good for putting houses on because they all crack and fall apart. Reactive place, but great native grass country. And that's just mowing a couple of times a year and selective herbicide application. sad thing about that is that those people have sold that property and it's been cropped and subdivided, so all that's gone. But it just reiterates what Wayne was saying, that you can often look at a site and go, if you've got a bit of an eye for it, you've got potential, put a little bit of money, a little bit of time into it, and all of a sudden your remnant can look like that. And that's what we get the potential for in South Australia, we've just got to find those remnants in the market. But I guess that's another thing about this whole thing of you know, wanting to go out there and do all these big restoration projects. We've got some fantastic remnants out there, you know, and some of the ones I'm speaking of are actually owned. The tenure of that land is Transport Department land, and they're busy trying to put it down, you know, restore native grasslands on some crappy Adelaide Plains soil that's had all these weeds and herbicides and things like that, and then you go up and just use railway corridors and Adrian and Prescott went out there after me going, oh wow, there's a few grass species out there, and next minute they've gone out there and found 75 grassland species, you know, in the remnant area. But that area gets no protection. You know, people go and dump rubbish on it, people go and farmers go and plough it up and sow crops in it and whatever. So, you know, what should we allocate resources to? Should they just forget about restoring, you know, trying to restore into areas and just go and protect that? I think, you know, my opinion would be that would be more valuable. Where it's at, so I think that's all I've got.
Yeah, well, that's
even with my stairs. Yeah. Like
that's really good. But you can be the cup again.
Right.
You're going to be on a panel or something.
Oh, okay, good.
Yeah. I think we'll chug along. So if we can hold questions for Tim.
I've got another time now.
What we're doing actually, and I didn't explain it to everyone, we're going to buy these people a cup of coffee during the afternoon, which is not on the program. But yeah, so you're going to get a little chance for after the next speaker, a quick caffeine hit.
Where's Tamika? I'll just press escape.
Yeah,
you can just go